Recorded Books presents Manhunter by Matt Braun, narrated by Richard Ferrone. Author's note. The Old West produced a unique collection of rogues and rascals. Outlaws and grifters, gunfighters and gamblers, they formed a roll call unsurpassed for shady exploits. Certain of these men were supreme egotists, actively courting fame and glory. They manipulated the media of the day, and the media, with a public clamoring for larger-than-life heroes, was delighted to oblige. Dime novelists, abetted by newspapers and periodicals, transformed these rogues and rascals into the stuff of legend. Later, with a remarkable disdain for the facts, movies and television added their own brand of hype to an already false mythology. The end result was a pantheon of stalwart gunmen and chivalrous desperados. For the most part, it was folklore founded on invention and lies, and it was sold to America by hucksters with an uncanny knack for distorting the truth. Jesse James was one of the myths fobbed off on a gullible public. Far from the Robin Hood of legend, he was a paranoid outcast who robbed banks and trains rather than work for a living. He was also a master of propaganda. Throughout his career as an outlaw, he wrote articulate and persuasive letters to the editors of several Midwestern newspapers. The letters were duly reprinted and accounted in large measure for the belief that he robbed the rich and gave to the poor. In reality, he was something less than charitable. There is no documented instance of his assisting the needy or championing the cause of oppressed people. He was, moreover, a sadistic killer without mercy or remorse. Still, Jesse James captured the public's imagination, and he did it with a certain flair. He was his own best press agent. Yet, every myth has some foundation in fact. The Old West produced many man-killers who were both honorable and courageous. For the most part, however, they shunned the limelight. Because they weren't seeking fame or immortality, they made poor source material for dime novelists and hack journalists. The upshot was that their attributes were grafted onto the rogues and rascals. America, as a result, ended up revering men who deserved no place in our folklore. The truly legendary characters of the era became little more than footnotes in the pages of history. Luke Starbuck was one such man. His character is a composite of several Old West detectives who were the most feared man-killers of the day. They worked undercover, generally in disguise, and thus their exploits are not widely known. In The Manhunter, Starbuck accepts an assignment that pits him against Jesse James. Though the events depicted are historically accurate, certain liberties have been taken regarding time and place. Yet the characters are real, and the revelations unearthed by Starbuck are fact, not fiction. His investigation at last brings to light the truth about Jesse James. 100 years overdue, it is nonetheless a story that needs telling. The Manhunter also reveals Starbuck's role in the death of Jesse James. A compelling tale, it was until now shrouded in mystery. Luke Starbuck told no one of the part he played. For he was a man of many parts and many faces, none of them his own. Chapter 1. The men rode into town from the north. Their horses were held to a walk, and they kept to the middle of the street. Unhurried, with 3 riders out front and 2 more trailing behind, they proceeded towards the center of town. No one spoke. The community, like many Midwestern farm towns, was bisected by a main thoroughfare. The business district, small but prosperous, consisted of 4 stores, a saloon and a blacksmith shop, and 1 bank. There were few people about and little activity in the downtown area. A typical Monday morning, it was the slowest time of the week, which, in part, accounted for the five riders. Their business was better conducted in confidence and without crowds. The men were unremarkable in appearance. Neatly dressed, they wore drab woolen suits and slouch hats. Three were clean-shaven, and the other two sported well-trimmed beards. All of them were above average height, but only one, somewhat large and burly, was noticeable for his size. Their mounts were an altogether different matter. At first glance, the animals appeared to be common saddle stock. On closer examination, however, a uniform sleekness and conformation became apparent. The horses were built for endurance and stamina, staying power over long distances. In the center of town, the riders wheeled to the left and halted before the bank. There was a military precision to their movements, smooth and coordinated, somehow practiced. The two bearded men stepped down and handed their reins to the third man in the front rank. Without hesitation, the two riders in the rear positioned their mounts to cover the street in both directions. A moment passed while one of the bearded men took a long look around. His bearing was that of a field commander, and he subjected the whole of the business district to a slow, careful scrutiny. Then, followed by his companion, he turned and entered the bank. Inside the door, he stopped and quickly scanned the room. The cashier's window and the vault were to the rear. He noted that the vault door was closed and, to all appearances, locked. To his immediate left, seated behind a desk, the bank president was engaged in conversation with three middle-aged men. By their dress and manner of speech, they were gentlemen landowners and, therefore, no threat. He pulled a .45 Smith & Wesson revolver from a shoulder holster inside his suit jacket.
"Get your hands up. Keep 'em up and you won't get hurt."
There was an instant of leaden silence. The cashier froze, watching him intently. At the desk, the president stared at him with disbelief, and the three customers swiveled around in unison. Suddenly, eyes wide with terror, one of them panicked and bolted from his chair.
"Robbers! The bank's being robbed!"
A gun exploded and the man staggered, clutching at his arm. His face went ashen, then he passed out, collapsing at the knees, and dropped to the floor. One eye on the cashier, the gang leader glanced over his shoulder. His companion, standing just inside the doorway, held a pistol trained on the men at the desk. A wisp of smoke curled upward from the barrel.
"God damn it," he said gruffly. "Did you have to shoot him?"
"Seemed like the thing to do. Leastways, it made him close his trap."
"Maybe so," the gang leader snapped. "But that gunshot will draw a crowd just sure as hell."
"I don't recollect that ever stopped you before."
"All right, forget it. Keep them birds covered while I tend to business."
With that, he walked to the rear of the bank and stopped before the cashier's window. He casually rested the butt of the Smith & Wesson on the counter and nodded to the cashier.
"What's your name?"
"Martin," the cashier muttered. "Robert Martin."
"Well, Mr. Martin, how would you like to make it home to supper tonight?"
"I'd like that."
"Then get busy and open that vault. No fool tricks or I'll blow your head off. Hop to it."
Martin eyed him steadily a moment, then turned towards the vault. A roar of gunfire, several shots in rapid succession, suddenly sounded from outside. The gang leader looked around and saw his companion peering out the door.
"What's that all about?"
"Nothing serious. Some of the locals got nosy and the boys warned them to stay off the street."
"Keep a sharp lookout."
Turning back, he started and let loose a harsh grunt. Robert Martin had the cash drawer open and was clawing frantically at a revolver hidden beneath a stack of bills. The gang leader pulled the trigger and his Smith & Wesson spat a sheet of flame. The slug punched through Martin's forehead and tore out the back of his skull. A A halo of bone and brain matter misted the air around his head, and he stood there a moment, dead on his feet. Then he folded at the waist and slumped to the floor.
Dumb bastard, the gang leader cursed savagely. Told you I'd blow your head off.
Leaning across the counter, he began scooping bills out of the cash drawer and stuffing them into his pockets. Once the drawer was empty, he wheeled about and marched towards the front of the bank. He signaled the bearded man at the door.
Let's go. We're all done here. What about the vault? No time. Another couple of minutes and the whole town will be up in arms.
The boys won't like it. They rode a long ways for a payday.
Tough titty, he barked. You should have thought of that before you got an itchy trigger finger. Come on, let's clear out.
The din of gunfire swelled as they moved through the door. Still mounted, the gang members outside were winging random shots through store windows along the street. The merchants and townspeople had taken cover, and as yet there was no return fire. Crossing the broad walk, the bearded men hastily swung into their saddles. Then, with everyone mounted, the robbers reined about and rode north out of town. A short distance upstreet, the gang leader abruptly brought his horse to a halt. Where the business district ended, the residential area began, and both sides of the street were lined with modest homes. Outside one house, a teenage boy stood at the edge of the yard. His eyes were filled with a mix of fear and youthful curiosity. He watched with wonder as the rest of the robbers skidded to a stop and turned their mounts. The gang leader calmly drew his pistol and extended it to arm's length. He stared down the sights at the boy.
Come out to get an eyeful, did you?
The youngster swallowed, licked his lips.
I didn't mean no harm, mister.
Your mama should have taught you better manners.
Thumbing the hammer on his pistol, the gang leader sighted quickly and fired. A brilliant red splotch appeared on the pocket of the boy's shirt. He reeled backward, then suddenly went limp and fell spread-eagled in the yard. As he hit the ground, the other bearded robber kneed his horse forward, blocking the gang leader.
Why'd you do that? Why'd you kill him?
I felt like it.
For God's sake, he's just a kid.
So what?
So what? You took your spite out on a kid, that's what. Watch your mouth.
The hell I will.
The burly rider reined his horse closer.
What's the matter, Frank?
Ask Jesse.
I'm asking you.
We didn't finish the job. Jesse said there wasn't time to clean out the vault, and now he's mad at himself.
Wasn't time?
The large man scowled, turned his gaze on the gang leader.
Then how come you had time to stop and kill that kid?
Don't push me, Cole.
And don't you try throwing your weight around. We didn't ride to hell and gone just to come away with chicken feed.
I told you to lay off. I won't tell you again.
Well, I'll damn sure tell you something. Me and the boys are gonna go back and empty that vault. You can come or stay as you please.
I'm warning you.
Jesse, one of these days you're gonna warn me once too often.
A shot cracked, and they instinctively ducked as a slug whizzed past their heads. Looking around, they saw a man standing in the middle of the street downtown. He had a rifle thrown to his shoulder, and as he fired the second time, other men rushed to join him. The gang leader booted his horse and rapped out a sharp command.
Too late now. Let's ride.
A barrage from downtown settled the matter. With lead whistling around their ears, the robbers bent low and kicked their mounts into a headlong gallop. Moments later, they cleared the edge of town and thundered north along a rutted wagon road. Their leader, well out in front, never once looked back. Chapter 2 Starbuck wiped his razor dry and walked from the bathroom. He selected a fresh linen shirt from the bureau, then took a conservative brown suit from the wardrobe. After knotting his tie, he slipped into a suit jacket and checked himself in the mirror. No dandy, he was nonetheless particular about his appearance. Turning from the mirror, He moved to the bed and took a .45 Colt from beneath the pillow. He shoved the gun into a cross-draw holster worn on his left side, positioned directly above the pants pocket. The holster was hand-sewn and wet-molded to the Colt, crafted in such a manner that his belt snugged it flat against his body. The natural drape of his jacket concealed the entire rig and eliminated any telltale bulge. Only those who knew him well were aware that he went armed at all times. Fully dressed, he walked towards the door leading to the sitting room. His suite in the Braun Palace Hotel was comfortable, though modest in size, and handsomely appointed. Off and on, after establishing headquarters in Denver, he had debated buying a house. His detective business kept him on the move, often for months at a stretch, and the cost of maintaining a suite on a permanent basis sometimes seemed exorbitant. Yet a house would have tied him down, and he wasn't a man who formed attachments easily. Besides, the hotel provided room service and laundry, not to mention a certain freedom of movement. All things considered, he was satisfied with the arrangement. It somehow suited his style. Entering the sitting room, he nodded to the girl and took a seat beside her on the sofa. A singer, her stage name was Lola Montana, and she was the star attraction at the Alcazar Variety Theater. She was also his current bed partner, and for the past few weeks, she had slept over almost every night. Still, in his view, she was a pleasant arrangement with no strings attached. A room service cart was positioned beside the sofa. Earlier, they had shared a breakfast of ham and eggs, topped off with sourdough biscuits and wild honey. Now, luxuriating over a cup of coffee, Lola sat with her legs tucked under the folds of a filmy peignoir. The swell of her breasts was visible through the sheer fabric, and she noted his appreciative glance. She vamped him with an engaging smile.
"You look real spiffy this morning, lover."
"I sort of like your get-up, too. Hides just enough to give a fella ideas."
"Ooh," she slowly batted her eyelashes. "I thought by now you knew all my secrets."
"Let's just say you showed me a few surprises last night." She laughed a low, throaty laugh.
"The way I remember it, you rang the bell a couple of times yourself."
"Worked out even then, didn't it?"
"How so?"
"'Cause you rung the ding-dong clean out of mine."
His bantering tone delighted her.
Normally reserved, he was a man of caustic wit, but little natural humor. Like everyone else in Denver, she knew he was a manhunter, by some accounts a man-killer, and a detective of formidable reputation. Danger intrigued her, and from the outset she'd been captivated by the fact that he looked the part as well. Corded and lean, with wide shoulders and a muscular build, he stood 6 feet tall. His eyes were pale blue, framed by a square jaw and light chestnut hair, and he gave the uncanny impression of seeing straight through another person. She thought his look not so much cold as simply devoid of emotion. The quiet, impersonal look of a man who would kill quickly and without regret. Today, however, his manner seemed light, almost chipper. She took that as a good sign and wondered if he'd decided to unbend a little, let her have a glimpse of the man beneath the hard exterior. She felt no real conviction that it was true, and yet a girl could always wish.
"Why not take the day off?" She stretched like a cat and gave him a beguiling grin. "We could just loaf around and, who knows, maybe I'd show you some more surprises."
"Don't tempt me," Starbuck said genially. "The day's already half gone, and I've got some errands that won't wait."
"You know what they say, all work and no play."
That's a laugh. You've kept me so busy, I haven't hardly had time to tend to business. Detective business? She inquired innocently. Or monkey business? Starbuck cocked one ribald eye at her. I'll give you three guesses, and the first two don't count. Mr. Mysterious himself, she mocked him with a minx-like look. Got a hot case cooking, honey bun? Come on, you can tell Lola. Strictly back burner, Starbuck said vaguely. Nothing worth the telling. She laughed spontaneously, in sheer delight. You're one of a kind, Luke. I've just been told to butt out, and damned if you didn't make me like it. That's real talent. Ask me no questions, and I'll tell you no lies. Starbuck understood it was a game, light-hearted and meant in jest. Unlike many women he'd known, she wanted nothing of him. A good time and a few laughs, along with their romps in bed, were all she sought from the liaison. She possessed a kind of bursting vitality, and she seemed to have discovered the instant recipe for fun. Then, too, there were her physical attributes, which amounted to an altogether stunning package. She was smallish and compact, with coltish grace and a dazzling figure. Her features were mobile and animated, with a wide, sensual mouth, and her hair hung long and golden. She was impudent and puckish, with a sort of mischievous verve, and the tricks she brought to his bed never failed to amaze him. All in all, she was his kind of woman, sportive and undemanding, with no claims on tomorrow or the future. He thought it might last a while. All right, lover, she said cheerfully. Off to the races. Get your business done and we'll save our playtime for tonight. That sounds like a proposition. There's one way to find out. Then I reckon I'd better drop around to the theater tonight. You miss my show and you'll never find out. How's that for a proposition? Best offer I've had today. She leaned forward and brushed his lips with a kiss. See you there. Count on it. Starbuck rose and walked to the foyer. He took a wide-brimmed Stetson from the closet, jammed it on his head, and then shrugged into his overcoat. When he stepped into the hall, Lola poured herself another cup of coffee and lounged back on the sofa. A slow kittenish smile touched the corners of her mouth. Outside the hotel, Starbuck turned onto Larimer Street. It was a bitter cold day, with savage winds howling down from the northwest. A metallic sky rolled overhead, and snow flurries peppered his face. As he passed the police station, he pulled up the collar of his coat and stuck his hands in his pockets. With the wind pushing him along, he rounded the corner and headed directly across town. Several minutes later, he crossed Blake Street. His destination was a small shop wedged between a pool hall and a hardware store. On the window was a neatly lettered sign, chipped and fading with age. Daniel Cameron, gunsmith. Pistols, rifles, shotguns. An overhead bell jingling-linged as Starbuck hurried through the door. The walls along both sides of the shop were lined with racks of long guns, and towards the rear, a glass showcase was filled with pistols. Beyond the showcase, a gray-haired man turned from a workbench at the sound of the bell. Starbuck brushed snow off his coat and moved down the aisle. Afternoon, Daniel.
Well, Luke, Cameron warmly shook his hand. I was beginning to think you'd forgotten our project.
No, Starbuck said equably. Too many irons in the fire, that's all.
So I've heard.
Cameron let a sly smile cross his face.
Apparently, Lola Montana is a full-time avocation.
Starbuck grinned.
If that means she keeps me busy, you're right. Of course, I wouldn't exactly call it a chore. No need to explain. Cameron lifted his hands in an exaggerated gesture. A man needs diversion. Enjoy it while you're young. I'm doing my damnedest, Starbuck said with heavy good humor. How are things with you? Any luck? Luke, I think I'm onto something. Not precisely what we're after, but close. Very close. Tell me about it. I'll do better than that. Come along and judge for yourself.
A master gunsmith, Cameron possessed an innovative mind and an unquenchable thirst to explore. Always receptive to a challenge, he had agreed to tackle a problem posed by Starbuck. The bullets commonly available were efficient killers, but poor man-stoppers. An outlaw, though mortally wounded in a gunfight, would often live long enough to empty his pistol. What Starbuck wanted was a bullet that would stop the other man instantly, neutralize him on the spot, and take him out of the fight. For the past several weeks, engrossed in the project, Cameron had experimented with radical new bullet designs. Today, he proudly demonstrated the end result. In the back room of the shop, Cameron lined up three Colt 45 shells on a table. The first was a factory loading with the standard round, pug-nosed bullet. The next shell, loaded with Cameron's new design, had a slug with shoulders which gradually tapered to a flat nose. The last shell was unlike anything Starbuck had ever seen. In effect, Cameron had turned his new slug upside down and loaded it backwards. The nose of the slug was now inside the casing, and the base, which was blunt and truncated, was now seated in the forward position. After a brief explanation, Cameron loaded the shells into a Colt 6-gun. Along the rear wall were arranged three bales of wet newspaper that had been tightly bound with rope. The distance was less than 5 yards, and each of the bales was marked with a bold X in the center. Cameron aimed and fired, shifting from one bale to another, splitting the X with each shot. Then he walked forward, followed by Starbuck, and cut the bales open with a jackknife. The experiment spoke for itself. The standard pug-nosed bullet had penetrated 3/4 of the way through the first bale. The bullet was virtually unmarred and still retained its original shape. The flat-nosed slug, which was slightly deformed, had penetrated more than halfway through the second bale. Within the third bale, the reverse-loaded slug had penetrated scarcely 1/3 of the way through the wet newspaper, yet the truncated base, upon impact with the bale, had been deformed beyond recognition. The entire slug had expanded, squashed front to rear, and emerged a mushroom-shaped hunk of lead.
"Quite an improvement," Cameron said, holding the slug between his fingertips. "The factory load expended all its energy drilling through the bale. Even my new design did much the same thing. But the reverse load, as you can see, the mushroom effect caused the bullet to impart its energy quickly and with massive shock." Starbuck was impressed. "Would it work the same way on a man?" "Much better," Cameron assured him. "The shock effect on human tissue would be far greater than it is on wet newsprint." "Would it stop him cold?" Starbuck persisted. "Dead in his tracks?"
"Good question."
Cameron's expression was abstracted.
"I suppose we won't know that until you shoot someone, will we?"
"What about accuracy?"
"Now there we have a slight hitch. At long range, it's not as accurate as a factory load. On the other hand, most of your work is fairly close up. What would you estimate? 5 yards? 10 at the outside?"
"I reckon it'd average that or less."
"Then you have no problem. Cameron tossed him the slug. Go try it on someone, Luke. I'm willing to bet it's a man-stopper.
Starbuck left the shop with a box of the new shells in his overcoat pocket. His faith in Daniel Cameron, however, rode in the cross-draw holster on his belt. The Colt was now loaded with blunt-nosed slugs. Starbuck's next stop was his office. Located around the corner from the Windsor Hotel, the office was a second-floor cubbyhole with no sign on the door and spartan as a monk's cell. Essentially, it was a clearinghouse with a secretary to handle correspondence and light bookkeeping chores. All else, especially matters of a confidential nature, Starbuck committed to memory. His secretary, Verna Phelps, greeted him with prune-faced civility. Her desk and chair, along with a battered file cabinet, were the only furnishings in the room. Her cool manner stemmed from the fact that she hadn't seen Starbuck in almost 2 weeks. Though Denver was a cosmopolitan city with a population approaching 100,000, one of the holdovers from its frontier days was an active and highly efficient gossip mill. Almost from the start, she had known the unsavory details of Starbuck's latest dalliance. And in her most charitable moments, she considered Lola Montana nothing short of a wanton hussy. With no great urgency, Starbuck sifted through a stack of mail, now several days old. One by one, he dropped letters from various railroads, stagecoach lines, and mining companies on the desk. A man of means, with investments in commercial real estate and a portfolio of major stocks, he had no compelling financial need to work. Then, too, his reputation allowed him to accept only those assignments that piqued his interest. Several of his previous cases were celebrated for the notoriety of the outlaws involved. He had been instrumental in ridding New Mexico of Billy the Kid, and largely through his efforts, Wyatt Earp had been run out of Arizona. Apart from his eminence as a detective, he was also noted as a man-killer. By rough calculation, since he never discussed the topic, journalists estimated he had killed at least 18 men. As a result, his fame had spread across the West, and he could now pick and choose from among the jobs offered. Yet fame, with the attendant publicity and newspaper photos, had destroyed the anonymity he'd once enjoyed. These days, he operated undercover and always in disguise. One letter caught his interest. Postmarked St. Louis, it was signed by the president of the International Bankers Association. Short and somewhat cryptic in tone, it requested his presence in St. Louis at the earliest possible date. He studied the letter a moment, then stuck it into his pocket. Looking up, he indicated the stack of mail he'd dropped on the desk. Write those outfits and tell them I'm unavailable till further notice. A spinster, Verna Phelps had plain dumpling features, and her hair was pulled severely away from her face into a tight chignon. She heartily applauded Starbuck's work as a detective and took a certain grim satisfaction in the number of outlaws he'd killed. Yet she disapproved of his personal life and viewed his conduct with women as reprehensible. Now, with a dour nod, she shuffled the letters into a neat pile.
Are you accepting the St. Louis offer?
Maybe, Starbuck said noncommittally. All depends on what they've got in mind.
How long will you be gone?
Starbuck shrugged. Look for me when you see me.
Very well.
Her voice was tinged with reproach.
And the hotel suite? Shall I look after it as usual, or will your lady friend be staying on while you're gone?
Never give up, do you, Verna? Starbuck smiled and shook his head. Follow the usual routine. Have the suite spruced up and tell the desk to send any messages over to you.
Just as you wish, Mr. Starbuck.
Hold down the fort. Starbuck waved, turning towards the door. I'll be in touch. Verna Phelps gave a rapid sniff and watched him out the door. She marveled at his devilish ways and his taste for cheap, tawdry women. Then, blushing beet red, she was jolted by a sudden thought. She wondered how it might have been if she were younger. Starbuck arrived at the Alcazar Variety Theater late that evening. The owner greeted him warmly and escorted him to his usual table down front. A complimentary bottle of champagne materialized, and he settled back to enjoy the show. Several men seated at nearby tables exchanged friendly nods, but no one attempted to approach Starbuck or engage him in conversation. A private man, he tolerated few questions. Nor would he indulge drunks or the idly curious. He was known on sight, and what he did for a living was no secret. Still, though he was widely admired, he never spoke of his business to anyone. That, too, was known, and while some people considered it eccentric, his wishes were respected. The sporting crowd of Denver had long ago learned to take him on his own terms, or not at all, which suited him all the way around. He was alone even in the largest crowd. Tonight, a solitary figure lost in his own thoughts, his mind centered wholly on the moment. Tomorrow he would entrain for St. Louis, and whatever happened would happen, all in good time. Before tomorrow, there was one last night with Lola, and not an hour to be wasted. His anticipation was heightened all the more as the curtain rose and the orchestra struck up a catchy tune. Lola went prancing across the stage, her legs flashing and her breasts jiggling over the top of a peekaboo gown. The audience roared, and she gave them a dazzling smile. Then her husky alto voice belted out across the hall. Oh, don't you remember sweet Betsy from Pike, crossed the great mountains with her lover Ike, with two yoke of oxen, a large yellow dog, a tall Shanghai rooster, and one spotted hog. Chapter 3. St. Louis itself was worth the trip. Starbuck arrived on a blustery January evening. From Union Station, he took a hansom cab to one of the fashionable hotels on Olive Street. There, he registered under an assumed name and gave San Antonio as his hometown. To all appearances, he was a well-to-do Texan visiting the big city on business. A precautionary measure, the deception had by now become second nature. Only a couple of months passed, the Police Gazette had done an article that labeled Starbuck the foremost man-killer of the day. He had no idea whether his notoriety extended as far eastward as Missouri. Yet he was a man who played the odds and assumed nothing. Outside Denver, he always traveled under an alias. After supper in the hotel dining room, he went for a stroll. St. Louis, with a population exceeding the half-million mark, was the largest city he'd ever visited. The downtown district was a hub of culture and commerce. Theaters and swank hotels, office buildings and banks and business establishments occupied several square blocks between Market Street and Del Mar Boulevard. A sprawling industrial section, which had gravitated early to the riverfront, lay stretched along the levee. Steamboats were rapidly losing ground to railroads, and the city had developed into a manufacturing center for clothing, shoes, and various kinds of machinery. Still, for all its advancement, St. Louis remained a major market for hides and wool, horses and mules, and a wide assortment of farm produce. However cosmopolitan,
It had not yet fully made the transition from its frontier origins. On the waterfront, Starbuck stood for a long while staring out across the Mississippi. The Eads Bridge, completed only 8 years before, spanned the great river like a steel monolith. Far in the distance, he saw the lights of towns ranged along the Illinois shoreline. Not easily impressed, he was nonetheless taken with the sight. He had traveled the west from the Gulf of Mexico to the Pacific coast, but he had never had occasion to look upon the Mississippi. The breadth of the river, with girded steel linking one bank to the other, seemed to him a marvel almost beyond comprehension. He thought back to his days on the Rio Grande and slowly shook his head. Age and experience, he told himself, altered a man's perception of things. A nomadic Westerner, Starbuck had grown to manhood in Texas. The Civil War, which had left him without family or roots, taught him that killing was a matter of expediency. Thereafter, he accepted abuse from no man and quickly accommodated those who overstepped themselves. For a time, he drifted from ranch to ranch, a saddle tramp beckoned onward by wanderlust. Then, all within a period of a few years, he went from trailhand to ranch foreman to range detective. Quite by coincidence, one job leading to another, he discovered his niche in life. Once his reputation as a manhunter spread, Starbuck branched out from chasing horse thieves and common rustlers. Offers from stage lines and railroads afforded greater challenge, and there he came into his own as a detective. Despite his renown, however, he was never really satisfied with yesterday's accomplishments. He enjoyed what he did for a livelihood, and he took pride in his work. Yet something of the old wanderlust still remained. He forever sought greater challenges, and he was cursed with an itch to move on to the next case. A blooded hunter, his quarry was man, and only when the chase was joined was he truly content. Now, his gaze fixed on the Mississippi, he wondered what tomorrow would bring. His wire had confirmed the time and place for the meeting. Otis Tilford, president of the International Bankers Association, was expecting him first thing in the morning. An assessment would be made, and assuming he passed muster, an assignment would be offered. The only imponderable was whether or not he would accept. He was looking for tomorrow's, not yesterday's, and nothing else would turn the trick. Nothing and no damn body. He turned from the wharves and walked towards his hotel. The Merchants and Farmers Bank building stood on the corner of 4th and Delmar. Starbuck entered the lobby shortly before 9 o'clock and took an elevator to the third floor. At the end of the hall, he spotted a door with frosted glass and gilt lettering. He moved directly along the corridor, observant and suddenly alert. The lettering on the door was sparkling fresh. Inside the waiting room, he closed the door and doffed his hat. A mousy-looking woman with gray hair and granny glasses sat behind a reception desk. She looked him over, stern as a drill sergeant, and nodded.
"May I help you?"
"I'm Luke Starbuck. I have an appointment with Mr. Tilford."
"Yes, of course."
She rose, bustling around the desk.
"Please have a seat, Mr. Starbuck. I'll inform Mr. Tilford you're here."
Starbuck watched as she hurried down a hallway. Then, still standing, he slowly inspected the waiting room. All the furniture, including the receptionist's desk and a couple of wingback chairs, looked as though it had been delivered only that morning. A door on the opposite side of the room was open, and through it he saw several clerks in what appeared to be a general office. Their desks and a row of file cabinets along the far wall also looked fresh off a showroom floor. Whatever he'd expected, something about the layout put him on guard. He made mental note to do lots of listening, play it close to the vest, and volunteer nothing. The receptionist reappeared, motioning him forward.
Will you come this way? Mr. Tilford can see you now.
Much obliged, Starbuck said pleasantly. I was just admiring your offices. Got a real handsome setup.
Thank you.
Been here long?
I beg your pardon.
Well, everything looks so new and all. I thought maybe you'd just opened for business.
No.
She did not elaborate.
This way, Mr. Starbuck.
Starbuck followed her down the hall. She ushered him into a spacious office and stepped aside. The room was paneled in dark wood with ornately carved furniture and a plush carpet underfoot. A coal-burning fireplace glowed cherry red, and directly opposite was an imposing walnut desk. Behind it, seated in a tall judge's chair, was a man who looked like a frog perched on a toadstool. He was completely bald, with a wattled neck and beady eyes, and his oval face was peppered with liver spots. When he rose, extending his hand, his posture was shrunken and stooped. Yet, oddly enough, his voice was firm and lordly.
Welcome to St. Louis, Mr. Starbuck.
Pleasure's all mine, Mr. Tilford.
Please be seated.
Tilford let go of his hand and dropped into the judge's chair.
I trust your trip was without incident.
More or less. Starbuck took an armchair before the desk. One train rides pretty much like another.
No doubt.
Tilford appeared to lose interest in the subject.
I appreciate your quick response to our request.
When a man says urgent, I take him at his word.
Commendable,
Tilford said, no irony in his tone.
All the more since your services are much in demand these days.
Don't believe everything you read in the Police Gazette. Tilford's laugh was as false as an old maid's giggle.
On the contrary, Mr. Starbuck, I found the article most informative. Few men have your zeal.
Oh? Starbuck asked casually. How so?
Once you accept a case, you display a remarkable tendency to see it through to a conclusion. Would you consider that a fair statement?
I generally finish what I start.
Precisely.
Tilford gave him an evaluating glance.
And more often than not, you finish it permanently, correct?
Starbuck regarded him thoughtfully. Why do I get the feeling you know the answer before you ask the question?
I, too, am a man of zeal, Tilford replied loftily. I had you checked out thoroughly before sending that wire.
Sounds reasonable, Starbuck smiled humorlessly. Hope you got your money's worth.
The queries were of a personal nature. A man in my position develops certain alliances, and we often exchange information. All on a confidential basis, of course.
Anyone I know?
What's in a name?
Tilford spread his hands in a bland gesture.
Suffice it to say, you come highly recommended by the Central Pacific and Wells Fargo.
I reckon they had no room for complaint.
Indeed, Tilford wagged his head. You are too modest by far, Mr. Starbuck. I am reliably informed that you have no equal when it comes to meting out justice to outlaws.
There's all kinds of justice.
True.
Tilford pursed his lips and nodded solemnly.
But only one kind of any lasting value. Wouldn't you agree, Mr. Starbuck?
Starbuck took out the makings and rolled himself a smoke. He struck a match, all the while watching Tilford, and lit the cigarette. Then, inhaling deeply, he settled back in his chair.
Suppose we get down to cases? By all means.
Tilford leaned forward, stared earnestly at him. I presume you are familiar with the James Younger gang? Starbuck looked at him without expression.
Jesse James?
Tilford made a small nod of acknowledgement.
Over the last 17 years, James and his gang have robbed dozens of banks and trains,
so I've heard,
and killed at least a score of innocent people.
I wouldn't argue the figure.
And yet, Tilford said in an aggrieved tone, they are free to come and go as they please throughout Missouri.
I understood, Starbuck observed it neutrally, that the Pinkertons had been brought in on the case.
Quite true. Tilford's eyelids drooped scornfully. Some 8 years ago, the Pinkerton Agency was retained for the express purpose of putting a halt to these depredations.
That long? Starbuck blew a plume of smoke into the air.
Guess they've had a run of bad luck. You're too charitable, Tilford said, not without bitterness. To put it bluntly, Alan Pinkerton has accomplished nothing, absolutely nothing, and he has been paid very handsomely for doing it.
Nobody's perfect, Starbuck commented dryly. Maybe it's time for the worm to turn.
I seriously doubt it. Tilford shook his head in exasperation. A coalition of banks and railroads still has Pinkerton under retainer. In my view, however, it's a waste of money. Given another 8 years, he would be no closer than he is today.
Sounds like you hold the Pinkertons in pretty low opinion.
Unless I'm mistaken, Tilford watched him carefully. That is an opinion we share.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.